In January of 1938, stories about the communists' 8th Route Army and new 4th Army and the conditions in communist-controlled areas were reported in the overseas Chinese news. The information was also provided to newspapers in Hong Kong, but the reports were rejected. Hong Kong had 1 million residents. About one-third of the population were British, and the rest were Chinese. Though Hong Kong was economically developed, it was thought of as a culture desert.
抗战初期的时候，大概有二三十种报纸，大部分都是一种意识形态比较淡，一般是适应那种小市民啦、商业性的比较多。
As the Japanese occupied more areas of China, this situation began to change as writers and intellectuals flooded into Hong Kong. 1937, most of Shanghai was occupied by the Japanese. As Shanghai, Nanjing, and Wuhan fell to the enemy, Hong Kong became a refuge for well-known writers and intellectuals. Ta Kung Pao was widely known as a newspaper that spoke up for the toiling masses. Founded at the end of the Qing Dynasty, it's the longest continuously published Chinese newspaper.
1937年七七卢沟桥事变，当时天津馆呢第一个的会馆了，因此呢，筹划要组织上海馆，就后来就在华都界啊，就建立了上海馆的大公报，啊。 但是临时不久啊，就发动了叫上海八一三的战争，啊，淞沪抗战呢，我们失败了。Zheng
Minjia worked on the newspaper for nearly 20 years. He believes that Ta Kung Pao mirrored the resistance of the Chinese during the war against Japan. After Shanghai was occupied, Ta Kung Pao relocated to Wuhan. But the Japanese overran that city and it was forced to move to Hong Kong.
半壁江山的能与敌手，江南一带所有的各地的文人、学者、作家都云集到香港来。这福山志士想啊，大公报有一个明确的思想，就是按照抗日统一战线呢、啊，这个精神呢、啊，来办报，来发言论的。
After arriving in Hong Kong in August of 1938, Ta Kung Pao urged residents to make a concerted effort to resist Japan and save China. It won the support of the 8th Route Army's Bureau in Hong Kong. Ta Kung Pao also published a literature supplement that introduced a new style to the city. Editor Xiao Qian and Yang Gong were the backbone of the publication. Though they were members of the Communist Party, this was unknown to the public. They introduced writings from Yan'an.
A 大事，就汪精卫啊，跟日本有一个秘密的签订，这个签订的一个协议叫做什么？叫《预知新关系调整的纲要》。 这个文件呢、啊，香港大公报拿到了，都把它全文头条全版登出来，都震动一时啊！这个就是汉奸呢、啊，跟日本合作要灭亡中国的一个很重要的文件，都在香港的社民啊，对大公报另眼相看了。
Hong Kong residents showed interest in the writings from Yan An, which was noticed by Zhou Enlai. In early 1938, Zhou met with Mao Dun, an author who was to become editor-in-chief of Literary Position magazine in Hong Kong. Zhou told him that articles written by intellectuals and senior party members in Yan An and other communist bases would be sent to Mao Dun to be published. Following his meeting with Zhou Enlai, Mao Dun and his family moved into a courtyard on Nathan Road in Hong Kong. The courtyard's kitchen was crowded and inconvenient to use. Mao bought an alcohol-fueled stove and cooked in their room. Cooking, washing, lighting, and even using the toilet were all difficult. To make it worse, Nathan Road had a tramway. Electric buses began operating at 4 o'clock in the morning and didn't stop until 1 o'clock the following morning. The noise of trams and pedestrians made it hard for Mao to write. Despite the difficulties, Mao considered himself to be a pioneer on an island he felt was forgotten by the modern world.
Mao Zedong 大学的报纸，但没有一份是进步的。第二个从思想内容讲呢，一个是黄色，另外一个低俗，还有一个呢就是这个没有思想内容，没有思想性。对小市民、广大的小市民呢，总的看法，他是改造就是追求梦死。
Mao Dun wanted to bring literature to Hong Kong. The vehicle was to be a literary periodical called Literature Position. It would promote advanced culture, literature, and art. Literature Position was edited in Hong Kong, printed in Shanghai, and distributed throughout inland areas and in Southeast Asia. It caught Liao Chengzhe's attention, and he asked an assistant, Du Ai, to have each issue of Xinhua Daily smuggled from Chongqing to Mao Dun in Hong Kong. One newspaper was often shared by dozens of readers, and this was an inspiration to Mao Dun. Mao Dun went to work writing articles for Literature Position and other magazines about literature and art in areas controlled by the communists. As intellectuals and writers from inland areas fled to Hong Kong, it gradually became a city of culture. The 8th Route Army's Bureau capitalized on this movement. Zhou Enlai approved the appointment of Hu Yuzhe to create a Hong Kong branch of the Chinese Association of Journalists. The idea was to unite Hong Kong journalists and promote a unified anti-Japanese front. One after another, progressive culture organizations were established in Hong Kong. In February of 1940, the Hong Kong branch of the All China Writers Association held a reception for two authors from northeastern China. Chow Hong and her husband, Du and Mu Hong Liang were considered by Lu Xun to be the most promising writers in modern China. Later, they were invited to Lu Xun's 60th birthday party. They created an entertainment event called National Soul of Lu Xun. At this party, Zhang Minjia, who often contributed to Ta Kung Pao, met Xiao Hong. Later, four scenes of National Soul of Lu Xun were serialized in Ta Kung Pao.
Lu Xun 先生是阴历8月3日，但是民国政府当时废除了阴历，废除阴历以后呢，他大概是按阳历算，应该是9月24日，是他的六十诞辰。那么上海的这个文化人呢，通过就征得徐广平的同意，就是还是按8月3日阴历的8月3日来纪念他的这个六十诞辰。
With Lu Xun's support, Xiao Hong finished her masterpiece, The Field of Life and Death. When she arrived in Hong Kong in 1940, she was seriously ill, but she had amazing willpower.
Xiao Hong, 在香港这长时间呢，他写了他一部小说叫做《呼兰河传》，这是他在香港一个最大的、最高的成就。
《呼兰河传》呢？他写了三个部分，一个呢是家乡的这种闭锁的平凡的这日常生活，第二个呢就是呼兰的精神方面的盛举，比如野台子戏啊、跳大神啊这些，那么第三部分呢，他就写了他的自己的张家大院，当时衰败的情景，那么同时呢，他又写了由于家里衰败呢，就很大的家院呢就出租给很多低层的这个房客，那么这些低层的房客的这种生活状态，生活状态里头的喜怒哀乐，那么呢，就里头就有很强烈就鲁迅的那种国民性。
Xiao Hong was a rising star in the mid-1930s. She exiled herself from northeastern China to northern China, then from Shanghai to Hong Kong, where she eventually settled. Xiao Hong died at the age of 31, with many of her dreams unfulfilled. Although very old, Zhang Minjia still goes to her tomb to burn incense. Zhang has never forgotten her, and neither has Hong Kong. In the history of literature in the city, there's no masterpiece quite like Tales of Hulan River. There's a cafe around the corner from the office on Queens Road Central. Liao Chengzhe joked that its free cubes of sugar attracted him and saved the cost of having meals provided for the office. The cafe was often visited by leftist writers and thinkers seeking refuge. They debated over afternoon tea. It united many of those leaning toward the Communist Party. Having set up propaganda units in publishing, movie and theater circles, the Hong Kong Bureau finally had a voice in the newspapers. Literature flourished in Hong Kong, and it became a culture center. When Mao Dun came to Hong Kong again in 1941, he found the culture desert had become an oasis. In early 1941, a plane landed at Kai Tak Airport. Following the new Fourth Army incident, in which the Communist Army was ambushed by government troops, Sha Yan was forced to stop publishing National Salvation Daily over his refusal to slander the new Fourth Army. His life was in danger, and the Communist Party moved him to Hong Kong. In March of that year, Zhou Taofun was also in trouble for criticizing the Kuomintang. He left for Hong Kong as a counselor. He'd been editor-in-chief of an influential publication called Public Life. Suppressed by the Kuomintang, many progressive thinkers, publishers, and journalists sought refuge in Hong Kong. Liao now decided it was time to raise their profile in the British colony. He sought approval for his plan from Zhou Enlai. As intellectuals fleeing the mainland arrived in Hong Kong, the Bureau saw a chance to promote the party through its own newspaper. Zhou Enlai approved, and Liao began to carry out the plan. Deng Wenzhao persuaded his older brother, Deng Wentian, to run the newspaper with them. They named it Hua Xiang Pao newspaper. Zhou Enlai had insisted the name not be too communist. The registered supervisor was Deng Wentian, a businessman. The three characters that made up the title were copied from Sun Yat-sen's handwriting and meant newspapers of overseas Chinese merchants. Its first edition came out on April 8, 1941. Fan Chang Jiang was the vice general manager. Zheng Youyou was the editorial page editor. And Hu Zhongcha was the editor-in-chief. Businessmen He Dong and Zhou Shouchen inscribed the first issue to make the paper appear more commercial. Each copy had four pages and cost 2 Hong Kong pennies. It soon had a daily circulation of more than 5,000. 40 days after its first issue, Zhou Taofun's Public Life resumed publication. Hua Xiang Pao and Public Life meant the office now had a comprehensive propaganda base in Hong Kong. They could now publish On Contradiction, On Practice, On the Protracted War, and other works by Mao Zedong. Liao's brother-in-law, Li Xiaosha, helped him translate Mao's works into English. On Dag Wheeler Street in Hong Kong, there used to be a bookstore selling English books. It was the first in Hong Kong to sell English versions of Mao Zedong's writings. On September 18, 1941, the highly political newspaper Bright was launched in Hong Kong. It was the 10th anniversary of the staged rail line bombing that had served as a pretext for Japan to invade northeastern China. Bright was the official newspaper of the China Federation of Democratic Political Groups. Liang Shuming had been given the job of establishing the paper. Zhou Enlai appointed Fan Chang Jiang to work with Liang. Fan learned that financial problems would prevent publication of the newspaper. He obtained 4,000 Hong Kong dollars from the Communist Party to back Liang. On October 10th, the declaration of the China Federation of Democratic Political Groups, soon to become the China Democratic League, was published in Bright. The China Democratic League emerged in the political arena as a third party.
国民党老是污蔑共产党，比方说是是听说那个话呀，共产呀，共产呀，而廖泽民呢通过发表党内人的文章，和他自己写的东西，使得国际上到国内改变对国民党宣传影响下的人们的看法，对共产党的看法。
That year was to witness the beginning of a period of darkness for Hong Kong. In late June of 1941, Germany invaded the Soviet Union. On December 7th, the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor and attacked Hong Kong. On the morning of December 8th, Biao called an emergency meeting.
八办，应该说对这个问题、对香港的特殊的地位有特殊的环境，就是清醒的认识。那么很早就开始筹划，那么日军一旦侵占香港，那么就要及时的采取包括人员、重要的人士的疏散等方面的工作。The plan
was to contact the guerrilla force in Guangdong and request a team to go to Kowloon to assist the evacuation. Hua Xiangpao and Public Life would suspend publication. Each member was told about the secret evacuation plan. The Japanese began to bomb Kai Tak Airport, and their army crossed the Sham Chun River to attack the new territories in Kowloon. The small garrison of British troops defending Hong Kong was overwhelmed. On Christmas Day of 1941, the island surrendered. The writers and intellectuals were a valuable treasure that brought progressive thinking to Hong Kong and helped lay the foundation for a culture boom. Forced to move again, where would they go? Join us for the next episode, Secret Rescue.